Gradually
peaceful. It's a great pleasure to have Satya Sahu back, one of our alumni who graduated in 2010. Right? And after his talk, we'll go for lunch if somebody is going to, wants to go for academia, can join. And then we'll have informal get together with the team, where you guys can ask him questions, or he can tell us about his experiences beyond Oasis, and then you can tell about all the exciting things you do. In particular, there are a number of things that involve biomedical and health kind of stuff. Please be sure to describe him on those things. From all I know, Satya is doing excellent progress in his career. He got a big UO1 grant that he's the PI of. I think folks from neuroscience at Case and somebody at Harvard, right? They are part of his team. So he's really on his way, and we'll continue to hear from him his progress. To you, Satya.
Oh, thank you. I would like to just thank Dr. Chet for inviting me. I was just thinking, this was the room that when we first came here to join Wright State, we had our first meeting here. I don't know if you can remember, but it was a rainy day outside. In October 2006, I think, when we first visited, Dr. Prasad was there, and other team members, Meena and Patrick and me, and Katsen. It's wonderful to be back here. The last time I made a presentation at Wright State was for my thesis defense, wearing the same shirt. So it's quite a change, 5 years, but some things don't change. So what I'm going to do today is just give a brief overview of what we are trying to do at Case Western. And it's an informal kind of approach. Please stop me whenever you have questions, and I'd be happy to get into additional details. So the topic, the title of the talk is a little of a mouthful. What I'm trying to bring here is because given our traditional focus in Oasis on role of ontologies as knowledge models that can drive a lot of different applications across different domains, what I wanted to emphasize was that if you move into something as new and sort of rapidly changing and sort of sunrise kind of domain in biomedical science these days is neuroscience, you still see a lot of role of this traditional computer science-based approaches of using ontologies. So the next slide, you know, for this group, I guess it's just preaching to the choir. Notions of big data, and big data is not a buzzword only in computer science. It has caught on a lot of attention in the biomedical community also. So you have examples of the Internet of Things. Most of you would be much better informed about Internet of Things than me. Then you have smart cities. That one example that I saw was IBM's latest initiatives, in, especially from the IBM Dublin group. They have been publishing a lot, and they got the best paper award at ISWC last year in the applications track, in news track. Then these are the more traditional sort of applications of big data for astronomy and for Project Neptune. But from this is something new that some of you might be already be familiar with. From the neuroscience community is the Human Connectome Project. So the Human Connectome Project is trying to do, as part of the Brain Initiative, most of you would have heard that President Obama announced last year. NIH, NSF, DARPA, many other funding agencies are putting in the amount of money and effort, initiative, announcing funding opportunities to do a similar kind of work that was done in the Human Genome Project, to the human brain. So the Human Connectome Project is part of this initiative. What they're trying to do is use two complementary sort of sensing mechanisms using magnetic resonance imaging to understand how different parts of the brains are connected and how. So the Human Connectome Project is actually one of the pioneers in big data and biomedicine. Why? I'll get to that. So I have sort of tried to create a data spectrum in just in neuroscience, not whole biomedicine, but just neuroscience, what kind of data they are collecting. This is actually from a very good paper that some of you might be interested to follow up later on, the data challenges that neuroscience is facing. So along the temporal dimensions, you have information being collected at the millisecond and the second level to a period of months, like brain regions develop over a period of month. And the level of granularity, so synapses, connections between two neurons, neural cells, to at the level of the whole brain. So when they are doing PET imaging, they are imaging the whole brain. So you have the complexity in terms of the temporal and the granularity, and these are the kind of data being collected. And of course, you know, using our traditional computer science notions of big data, you have size. So some of this data are hundreds of gigabytes large. The Human Connectome Projects has already generated, I think, about 50 terabytes of data over the last couple of years or so. In our case, Western, the epilepsy unit, the director of the epilepsy unit I was just talking to, he's a collaborator. They have about 34 terabytes of data of just signaling data. Signaling data is basically EEG and MEG kind of data. So these are, they put electrodes in the brain and record data for different epilepsy patients. So variety, the modality that you see, this is signal, time series data, value over a period of time, imaging data. What you have here is, let's say another example I can take is diffusion weighted MR, I'll get into. But microstimulation is again a completely different modality. How you store the data, how you analyze the data. Velocity, over a 5 day, standard 5 day epilepsy patients are admitted to the epilepsy unit for 5 days. They collect 24 hour recordings of video, EEG, MEG, and electrophysiological, like breathing patterns and ECG data also. So the velocity of data creation is also very high. So broadly, if you take a step back and say what are the broader challenges from a computer science perspective in biomedical research, and that's where my primary interest lies, you have similar kind of problems we have tried to address in sensor or in traffic management or in web information systems. Integrate disparate data sets. You have to reconcile semantic, syntactic, structural heterogeneity. How you reconcile it for the clinical objectives that the clinicians are interested in is a challenge. Another important challenge in rapidly that is becoming a problem in biomedicine is this multiple center based scrums. Why? Increasingly, medicine is being seen as a team science. So you bring in a cardiovascular, you're a neurologist, you bring in a signal processing expert, you bring in biostatistics. So the problem is when you're transferring data. In biomedicine, the problem, additional problem is privacy, patient privacy. You cannot transfer protected health information across your institutional centers. You have to de-identify that. And that's something that some of you might, who are interested in cryptography or privacy preserving data mining kind of approaches, you have to apply those kind of approaches for de-identifying patient data. Heterogeneous modalities I've already covered. And the second is, most of the data that is collected when you go to a hospital as part of routine clinical evaluation, NIH is pushing, and CDC also, Center for Disease Control and Prevention, is pushing that we want this data to be analyzed later on for advancing research. So if you are collecting epilepsy, the EEG signal data, can you later on do a large cohort, 1,000 patients, and see patterns emerging between different kinds of epilepsy patients? Are there similarities, are there differences? Who is performing well for this kind of medication approach and versus others? So the point is that we have to maximize the returns on the research dollars. And of course, when you bring in 1,000 patients, 10,000 patients, and so on at the population level, the quality of inferences that you're able to do are statistically significant. And that's an important problem in primary medicine. You have to, you cannot just generalize that I saw on 2 patients, this thing succeeded. So this should be part of the standard clinical practice. It has to be at the level of thousands and thousands of patients across different subpopulations. African Americans, whites, Asians, socioeconomic conditions, education level, and so on. So these are the variabilities that we have to take into consideration.
So is it relatively clear to all parties? down and say, look, here are all this data that could potentially be used or could have been potentially used for secondary analysis, and yet I can't because it lacks all these metadata.
Yes.
Somebody's actually done a...
We faced that problem in the National Sleep Research Resource at Harvard.
Mm.
They have 50,000 studies being put together and being uploaded into the cloud.
Mm.
But when they sat down to do cross-cohort analysis, they said, oh, this variable, let's say just the occurrence of atrial fibrillation, this measured differently in different studies.
Mm.
It's self-reported, somebody just filled out a questionnaire, it was clinically evaluated, or they inferred it from the polysomnogram.
Mm.
There's some data being collected in the clinics.
Mm.
How do you compare? So somebody's self-reported is not as accurate as somebody is clinical.
Mm-hmm.
So you need to have that provenance information, how this variable value is being collected. And that's what our EO1 is trying to address. We are going to model that information in a formal way and then put it as part of when the clinicians are creating the cohorts, inform them, this is from this study, this was actually collected this way. But they had not been considered.
Mm-hmm.
So from our perspective, from the computer science perspective, the challenge becomes, how do you reliably store this data? That's an important consideration. I was just talking to a colleague of mine who has office next to me. They are doing community-based studies in Cleveland, and they were backing up to a local server. Over the summer, apparently, they lost 45 audio-visual interview tapes they had been storing on a server because somebody forgot to back them up, and the server developed some problems. So take it, and this is just 45, and I'm talking about when you take into consideration the signal data, 36 terabytes of data. You cannot put it on a server and expect, you know, the system just to automatically scale up to that level. You need specialized techniques to address that. Integrate, I've talked about, process that data in short amounts, and querying that data. When you have patient data over 5 days, I keep giving example of epilepsy because that's what I'm working on and familiar to me, but you can actually apply it to any other domain. Seizure, the occurrence of the epileptic seizure occurs for 30 seconds, maybe once, maybe twice over the 5 day period. But you have collected all this 24 hours data. And if the clinician is interested, how do they quickly retrieve this data, 30 second data from 1,000 patients? If you're storing it in a file based system, you can say how long it's going to take for you to query a 36 terabyte data store. It's like a, you know, the old tape-based systems that we used to have, a mechanical arm going in and pulling out the tape. Can we do better than that? So that those are the kind of questions we have trying to address. And of course, most of you are, you know, this familiar. This particular image I put there for fun because this is the Google's famous barge data center. I don't know if some of you might have heard that it was actually declared as a fire hazard by the Coast Guard, and they had to scrap it after investing, I don't know, a couple of $1 million or something, I think. So we clearly see that these are some of the computing technologies that can address some of these issues that we're facing in clinical big data.
Sure. When you say the real time, you mean that you want the answer of the query to be as much responsive as possible? Or you want to get the answer as soon as possible, comparing to the data coming in? Like, having the data, I want the answer immediately, or thinking about the query, I want the answer immediately.
Both.
Okay.
I'll give you an example. You put a patient in an MR machine, doing functional magnetic resonance imaging, Alzheimer's patient. You are showing them some questions, and they are reacting, answering those questions. For example, do you recognize this house? The machine is basically imaging which parts of the brain are lighting up. Based on the answers they are giving and which parts of the brain are lighting up, you would like to zero in into more particular, you know, that particular set of patterns. For example, memory retrieval is one task. So task-based questions you want to focus, they looked at the house, can they look at the person and maybe recognize their family and so on and so forth. You want to pursue that line of question. But unless you get back from the data processing system, the analysis of the images that the fMRI machine is recording, you cannot change the questions in real time. The patient is sitting in the machine.
Sure.
So those are the kind of real-time responses that we're looking at.
Is a kind of continuous query answering?
Yeah, at one level.
Okay.
But another can be clinical decision support. A clinician has to take a decision. that should they be considered then for a surgical intervention because they're not responding to drugs. So those are clinical decisions. Versus the other one, which is actually just evaluation level real-time response that you're looking at.
Okay, so this part is more reactive programming.
So the real-time, what I mean is, maybe I should make it clear, it can be in different contexts, mean, you know, similar kind of things. But the point is, the response time has to be faster.
Sure.
Right now, the signal processing takes 7 days. You cannot wait for 7 days because the patient's already gone home to make a clinical decision.
Right. So we want to see both streaming and real-time processing. Thank you.
So in today's talk, basically, I'm just going to cover these four themes that I have been working on over the past 4.5 years or so. As Akshay mentioned, when you're collecting data during the clinics, you have to have the information being collected of good quality, because if it's garbage in, garbage out, it has to have some kind of metadata associated with it. So we are trying to solve that using what is called an ontology-driven patient information collection system, OPIC. I'll show you some screenshots and discuss about that. Some amount of clinical text processing, so many of these textual documents that you'd be surprised in hospitals, they are collecting Word documents, sentences of the description instead of in some kind of structure. We try to use an ontology-driven approach to process epilepsy discharge summaries and see what we could get out of that. The real-time processing I'm going to talk about in terms of the electrical signal data. And the last one is something that we have recently got onto is this provenance-enabled research cohort identification. So clinicians can go in and look at the provenance of how the data was being collected in different studies and so that they can integrate and create their research cohorts.
So what is this EPDA?
So that's the epilepsy data extraction and analysis. Those are sort of, we created logos and names for these kind of things.
Yeah, but these are not related to, what is related to data quality? Is the OPIC, EMC?
So OPIC is for this, yeah, for consistency in data quality. Because what we are trying to do is make sure the data is being entered in drop-down menu values driven from the ontology concepts rather than just free text entries. So that's for the data quality in that sense. This is related to the clinical text processing. This is using the Hadoop technology stack for signal processing, and this is for the creation of
research. Clinical text processing only for epilepsy.
Yeah, because the ontology was epilepsy related. But we extended CTEX by using a better name entity recognition tool and negation detection and those kind of things. So using the ontology, we were able to get much better as compared to something like from NLM, MetaMap that gives you from UMLS that has very high level granularity, doesn't have the concepts related to epilepsy that we're interested in. So I'll just give a small.
I think the question is, you know, for those of you who work with ZDI, is there a counterpart to building one that focuses on capturing on consultancy by CD10?
So before I get into OPIC, let me just give you an overview of how the data flow occurs in epilepsy neuroscience specifically. So you have patients being admitted, signal data being recorded, annotations happening saying that, for example, here there is something is occurring, can be a seizure or something else, and you store it in some sort of a file system. What then you do is you have additional information, for example, the patient demographic information that is entered by the clinicians as part of the admission process. Earlier it used to be a Word document, we sort of automated that. But whatever has been there for last 15 years or so, we are trying to use clinical text processing to get that into a sort of a standard data structure for querying, where you have this patient query, cohort query interface, using the ontology for creating your cohorts and exploring the data sets that you're collecting. And the last part, of course, is I'm going to talk about a little more because that's what my recent work has focused on. Using the Hadoop technology stack for processing the data and making it the signal data and making it available for the clinicians to analyze and explore that. So first is OPIC. So from a computer science perspective, this is nothing very innovative or something very complex or challenging that you can publish in BLDB or ICD. But from a biomedical perspective, why is this important? Is you compare it to a Word document based system. This form that you're seeing, actually, these are the three students who have worked. Meng Zhao started working on this first. Su Chang is working on the current form, and Priya has also contributed. She contributed 1 year of work in terms of structuring the input values. But just to give an example, when the clinicians are putting in where seizure is occurring, these all the concepts that you're seeing here, these are actually from the foundational model of anatomy, FMA ontology. This we didn't create. This basically hierarchical structure representing that which part of the brain is contained within which was captured from FMA. And we took, only because FMA covers the whole human body, we actually used OWL API, most of you would be familiar with that, to extract out related to brain. And it has exquisite level of modeling, the level of detail is just fantastic. And it's very clinically relevant. So we took it, and this form basically reads it from the ontology stored in a database, but populates it from there. And it allows the clinicians to go to any level of detail that they want to get. And when it's selected, so those values that you're seeing there, not clearly, I guess, those are actually ontology concepts. So later on, when you're querying this data, you're actually using the ontology concept directly in your query formulation and execution rather than just plain text. So the primary issue here for the data quality was the consistent use of terminology. And I'll get to that, how it's doing consistent terminology.
You know, the question that comes to my mind is that while you got the terminology or annotation at this level, collect data collection level, from these ontology, the anatomy ontology, what about the later use of this data? For example, if I want to use this data for billing purpose, and for that I have to use ICD-10, what level of coherence there is between the two? So what it says that the use of model, the ontology, and the data collection time vis-a-vis how you will use, let's say the secondary use of the data may be very different.
Mm.
And so there may remain challenges. Now if you knew ahead of the time, which maybe you don't, this will certainly benefit and facilitate, but if you knew ahead of time what are eventual uses, then there's something more that can be done. And I don't know what research issues there are, just a question.
No, I mean, that's a definitely valid point, and that does not solve it. So the billing information, this is not for billing.
Mm.
Billing information, for that we take only parts of this data set and then add it as a PDF to the EHR system, because the EHR data... So ICD-9 codes are still not there. But for secondary use, most of the clinicians use the terminology that they are using here to put the data. So that is mapping. So clinical research is what I'm trying to address. Definitely not.
I just wanted people to remind of some research. Those of you know the Observer project, where we say that the data is annotated using one ontology, but the query is using another ontology. And we started doing that. I see that being reinvented even now after 20 years now.
This was with Edward Mellon?
Yeah, 1996.
So since clinicians have used to write them as natural text, how would we motivate them to use this kind of detail? Would it be a challenge? Or
it is a challenge. So this was mandated by the director of the Epilepsy Center, our collaborator. Mm-hmm. But when the research fellows come in, they are on a fast-time basis. You know, they have to attend their classes, they have to do the clinical rotations, and they have to complete whatever patient evaluation they have done. They hate this. Hated this in the beginning. But when it comes from the top, that you either do this, or then we'll see how you graduate, then it changes the work culture. And once you get into the habit of doing this, then you can see that you get used to it. So somebody who's using Word or a PowerPoint, and somebody who has worked on slides, there's a different sort of approach. But once you get used to it, you'll get comfortable. And you see the advantages later on, because you can immediately pull up the patient's chart information on the day of the discharge and see what was the medication he was prescribed on the day of admission. If it were Word, then they would have to go into the file system and locate the Word document that was initially created. And maybe there somebody put in wrong information. Here you cannot put in wrong drug names. This is actually, the drug names are from RxNow, Olivier's work. and those are standardized, and they reconcile between the brand names versus the precise drug ingredients and the drug ingredients.
Specifically epilepsy, right? There are a lot of unknown factors. Anything you work on, brain, or a lot of unknown factors which might not be there in any ontology, or how would you handle those issues?
We spend 3.5 years building the ontology with the clinician. That's what we did. So we work with the domains.
Even the medications you told, right? Some medications might work, some medications might not work.
But those are standard. So you first give this. If this does not work, you move to this. If that does not work, then you see whether there's a surgical intervention that's required.
Epilepsy is being treated as is right now. There are usually most medical disciplines have their own group, and then they have protocols for, basically guidelines that they have, which are documented. You're supposed to follow them. You can get sued if you do not follow them. So these, in the standard practice sense, because these are, clinicians who are treating the patients, they have to follow that. And that level of knowledge and information can be accurately captured. There's yet things that people are doing research on, which hopefully they hope to become part of the guideline and modify the guideline because new knowledge is coming in. And that is what this can facilitate, even if the current information is collected properly.
So this I can quickly go through. So the ontology that is powering this is basically, this slide is strong for clinicians. So most of you are familiar with all of this. Epilepsy and seizure ontology that is being used in OPIC is based on the standard of classification of epilepsies and seizures in the community. So we work with, the professor, and of course this also, the International League Against Epilepsy is a standards body like W3C, which prescribes how epilepsies are classified and the location information has to be modeled, and we followed the recommendations because some of our collaborators are also members of the EDR classification committee. So this is just a snapshot of the ontology that some of you would be interested in. This is the EFSO. What we are trying to model here is, just to give an example, the different types of epilepsy. So you can see the classification of epilepsy based on focal epilepsy, that is epilepsy occurring in a particular part of the brain, versus at both parts of the brain, that's biloba. Generalized epilepsy is the epileptic seizures occur in different parts of the brain. Under that, this particular type of epilepsy, we are trying to capture all this information that are useful for the clinicians, like preferred medication. What are the kind of signal data that events that you will see when you look at the EEG, like polyspikes, sharp waves, and spikes? What are the kind of seizure patterns that you see? What is the cause of this? For AD and FLE, they actually say it's mutation, and we're able to capture all this genetic names of the genes that are being correlated to gene ontology terms. So you have now suddenly the ability to cross over into other kinds of knowledge bases that were not originally part of the clinical. So,
but how did you connect with the gene information if that was not in the literature that was just created?
The clinician didn't have access to it, but it was in the literature.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. So this is from
this is
curated knowledge.
Semantic enhancement.
This is curated knowledge. There's nothing new that we are adding. This is the I read up the papers and I was vetted by the clinicians and then I added these terms, but I'm linking it with using basically C also, or you can add a basically a link like a label kind of thing with a gene ontology identifier. So, and of course, this is also of importance that has age of onset, because then when you're creating research cohorts, age is a very important factor when you're creating cohorts, so that information is also correct. So, at this level of granularity, if you are able to have the information, this level of granularity is not always reflected in OPIC, but I'll show you when it is used in the research cohort query part. Now, OPIC, as I said, why it's helping maintain data consistency is being deployed. This is just a recently funded grant that we got last year, Center for SUDEP. SUDEP is Sudden Unexpected Death in Epilepsy. This is an initiative of the NINDS at NIH. We have about 9 partners, or maybe 10 now. And OPIC has, I don't know what this thing is. And also I want to point out is the University College of London. So they have actually deployed OPIC in their epilepsy units to collect their information. So in the multi-center study, everybody is using the same software to collect their information. That's how we're sort of ensuring the data consistency. Going to the next part, next is Epidia. Most of you would be familiar with these kind of information. This was actually worked by another PhD student, Lisong Sui. This is how the discharge summaries or information captured in the paper document looks like earlier, before OPIC was used. So you have some amount of structure, you can clearly see, but other kind of information that a particular type of seizure progressed into another kind of seizure, and then finally this generalized chronic seizure is in generalized epilepsy. This is the final phenotype that you see in patients. In addition, you can have additional information like localizing sign means during seizure, because it's happening in the brain, muscles have been affected. So that show up as different kind of twitching, hand twitching or mouth twitching, you know, and blank stare kind of thing. So lateralizing sign is another information that you're collecting. What we would like to do is take this kind of information, and again that you see here, all the medication information, they are a mix of brand names, drug ingredients, brand names, you know, those kind of things. There, you have no information which are similar, which one of them are anti-epileptic, which one are neuroleptic, which one are antidepressant. you don't have this information. The idea is, this is an interface that was built by Lisong. I'll show you a similar this thing, because this was actually a GQ student, so they have taken this with them. But we have another similar kind of code identification thing. On the left-hand side, you see is all the ontology terms. These are directly coming from the epilepsy and seizure ontology. Here you can select, this shows the demo part, but you can select data from different centers, UCL or Harvard or Iowa or whatever. Here you have what is called query widget. So for gender, you have the particular values you're getting from the database, age similarly. Particular type of seizure, you can specialize. And when you say run query, you are getting the patients who satisfy those set of values. So that's your research cohort. I'll show you another one. Another example of a research cohort identification interface. So all this information that I spoke about, this is the book. This most of you would be interested in. Is you take the discharge summary, we use CTEX. Many of you would be, you know, maybe Ashutosh actually worked on CTEX directly.
Sujan,
you worked directly on CTEX, developed at Mayo. It was trained on the UPenn data set, I think, a Penn State data set and Genia data sets, right? But for epilepsy, we found that we could not use MetaMap for named entity recognition. And that's where we brought in the ontology for epilepsy-related entity recognition. And also in terms of negation detection, because you had comments like, this patient did not suffer from focal epilepsy or particular type of seizure event, or spikes were not seen in EEG. So, those kind of things. Very simple, this was a proof of concept implementation we did. The idea was that we can process all this information and feed it into an interface that clinicians will be able to then access all the discharge summaries from the last 2 years or 5 years. And we got pretty good results. I don't think I have a slide for that. No, I don't. We got like, I think, 80 to 90% precision and recall, those kind of values. So it was an interesting concept. I don't have anything actively going on, but again, the role of the ontology was important. When people say that UMLS is a huge biomedical resource that you can directly use, what we have seen from our own experience, it doesn't have the level of granularity and the precision that's required for very specific clinical objectives. You need to develop, have your own domain ontology, your own knowledge model to be able to support these kind of tasks that you're interested in.
We work with a company called ZDI, and they had the same problem. They tried to use CTEX before that, another pass called Medley, and the quality of annotation was poor. Again, the purpose is different, yours is different. And so, again, I think Sujan was the guy who first worked on how the role of use of ontology that we developed. In this case, there was a lot more cardiovascular concepts, right?
Yeah.
And then the results were far better than before. And so, the point here is that.
So, did you compare the meta-analysis index on your domain? Or?
Yeah, we did, but informally.
Okay, which one was the CTEX?
MetaMap we use only for annotation purposes, not for processing the documents. CTEX
okay.
We use for processing the documents.
Okay.
MetaMap we invoke for name entry recognition,
yes, yeah.
But it, you know, there is this, things were like just limbs, even kind of limbs when you're doing lateralizing sign. Particular finger is twitching, or you know, you have particular formations of the limbs. MetaMap did not have those functions.
So is it because both use VNX, right?
Yes.
If you plug the your knowledge base to MetaMap or CTEX, will they do the same? Or?
No, if you plug in the Exo ontology to CTEX,
yeah.
What is ours input? If you use MetaMap, you changed, I think you would have changed the name entity recognition module of CTEX, most probably.
Yeah, it is there. So, I think, so CTEX has its own name entity.
Yes.
And MetaMap only does the...
just the name entity,
right?
Yeah.
So, if you compare these two components...
Ah, that's different.
Okay.
That's different. Because CTEX was never meant to have specialized applications in any particular domain.
Yeah.
It is just oriented towards, because it came from WIMA, which was originally trained on web information, you know, data sets. They just trained on Genia and some clinical tech data from the Mayo EHR that Jyoti actually was part of, and with Sui Tao, I think.
Hong Kong Lu.
So they did a general training of the name entity recognition, but it was never, they never meant it for specific cardiovascular or epilepsy or any, you know, this thing. They were clear that you have to develop your own rules or external knowledge models. But if you take in MetaMap, which is supposed to represent all the UMLS information, still it's not giving you the level of knowledge that you are interested in. That was the point. Okay, So signal processing is what we are working on right now. And I'll basically show how we are able to use some of these Hadoop. This is a slightly dated, because now we are actually moved from MapReduce to creating big scripts. But we haven't used Spark. Some of you have been using Spark and I would be interested. But to do that, what we need is sort of a better analysis. So if you had looked at the previous slide, so this signal data, as I mentioned, is large in quantity. You should be able to process it faster, detect what's happening at different parts of the brain, and then only we can go on to the fiber tractography part.
So it feels like your work is more on the propagation of epilepsy, right? That's not still fundamental reasons for why it's happening. Am I giving the difference well? So something is happening and you're working on why it's propagating.
They're correlated,
okay.
So seizures basically are abnormal electrical activity in the brain.
Right.
They can occur because of, I would want to say thousands and thousands of reasons. Basic level, cell level changes. Another can be actually changes in the connectivity of the brain, which causes seizures to happen. It can be brain injuries. It can be development of lesions. It can be due to infections. So some of the infections, like Japanese encephalitis, you get seizures.
Actually, what is seizure? Because I'm not very...
Seizure is abnormal electrical activity.
Okay.
So
yeah,
normally...
Fits. Mm. Okay.
So that's the wrong term, but...
Yeah,
in India, I know this term.
But it's...
It's not fits, so
yeah.
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 Type of seizure.
Yeah.
So there can be any kind of seizure. So a seizure can also be that patients feel a metallic taste in the mouth. That's actually because of seizure.
Yeah.
They hear sounds that are not there. Those are also seizures. Those are audio, what is that called? Anyway, so the point here is, when you have this large amount of data and you need this real-time analysis support, and I'm just giving you this, the complexity of the problem. I have tried to plot till May 2013, we had collected about 10 terabytes of data, and this is the number of patients that we are collecting only for our clinical project. It was called PRISM. I won't get into that. But these are the total listing. But the data that you are seeing is within, what, 2 years, it was 10 terabytes. And right now I know for a fact that we have 34 terabytes of just signal data. I'm not even talking about the deficient MR data. So current approaches to storing the signal data, the de facto standard is something called European data format. It's just a semi-structured kind of file format. Most of you would actually have a smile on your face when you look at it. There is no option for any kind of annotations. You cannot store in a distributed file system. So the amount of data in one EDF file can be from a couple of 100 megabytes to 1 or 2 gigabytes. And there is no way that you can actually segment it into different parts. And that's where I'll come into how we're trying to do. This is, you know, of course, not suitable for processing and so on. And signal montages is, as I showed to you, there can be 10, 15, 20 electrodes in the brain. Each one of them has multiple contacts. Each contact is recording a time series value. So each one of them is called a channel. What clinicians are interested in is they will combine 2 or 3 of these channels in different combinations, what is called as montage. And they want to see how, you know, changes are taking place across 2, 3 of these channels at different time points. So the difficulty is when they're trying to compose these montages, right now they have to, you know, use application that proprietary application which tries to compose the montages. But if you have like 10, 20 of these 1-2 gigabyte files, the application basically freezes up. And of course, you know, kind of interoperability, if data is being collected from one center versus another center, is almost zero because you don't have any metadata information associated with it. So you have to manually reconcile all this heterogeneity to be able to compare signal data from different centers. What we did was just a simple approach to use a JSON-based format where we sort of segregated the metadata information. So you can have different kinds of metadata. Here you see about the study itself. So you have patient information, duration of the recording, how many channels are being recorded, clinical events, what time a particular seizure is occurring, and the ontology annotation. You have signal-specific metadata. These are very important from the signal perspective, at what sampling rate they are being collected, what's the filter being used, and so on and so forth. And you have the actual data. These are binary time series data sets. The point is, this data set, and I'll get into that in the next couple of slides, it allows us for the ontology annotations, but what's more important is we can partition the data into different segments that are self-descriptive. Why is it important? Is, as I told you, right now the current state of the art is a standalone application that clinicians use to visualize the signal data. This is our own application. Web-based interface that you can compose the montages I was talking about, right? So each one of them, if you see, you can't see, each one of them is a channel. They can be combined into different combinations. You can apply different kinds of filters. This is by 2 students. Catherine was a PhD student. Anand is a master's student right now. We built an interface that could visualize this signal data along with annotations from the ontology classes. So if events are happening, you won't be able to read. Actually, I can't read from here. So onset of seizure activity, I think that's what, or jittery phase, sorry. Onset of jittery phase, this is what it says. These are actually events that clinicians put in by hand. We map it to the ontology. So clinicians now can query, give me patients who suffered jittery phase, you know, for the 32nd part they're interested in across last 1 year or so. Your question.
So how do the clinicians actually put the events? Do they look at the video of the patient?
Manually.
Oh, okay.
There are automated methods, but it's not completely trustworthy. These are signal processing algorithms, and I'll come to another one example that we did. But right now it's put manually.
So all discipline of radiology is like that, right? I mean, visually inspection of the things. electrocardiography, just like that. So these guys are trained. Even also, you know, earlier, now there is much better resource on breast cancer detection automatic. But if you go back 10 years, and there was pretty poor, you know, much different thing.
Yeah, some of the things like jittery behavior, right? Maybe the doctor can identify. Whereas if you want to go from signal, it might be much harder. Unless there is some ground truth. Or
no, the doctors can see from the signal.
Right. So they look at the signal,
they say this is abnormal. This is
okay.
Particular type of abnormality. Jittery is a particular type of abnormality.
Mm-hmm.
Start of seizure is another event and so on. That's onset of clonic seizure. So clonic seizure is a particular type of seizure. This is where it starts.
Each of the signal line here like that is for a particular electrode?
Actually, it's a combination of electrodes.
Okay.
So this is one electrode, FP1,
mm-hmm.
F7. That's how they label it.
Well, you know, I mean, you can imagine that if a very large amount of such annotation data is available, then clearly you will apply machine learning and try to figure out, and then...
Yeah, actually, my other concern is that there might be things that may not really manifest in a signal.
True.
So that might be... is that a concern?
Video. They collect video.
Right.
Of
okay.
patient also. 24/7. I mean, not 24/7. 24 hours for the 5-day period that they are in.
Okay.
And they correlate it.
Right. Yes. I can imagine electrodes may not be able to capture all the...
Yes. Yes, so many of these presentations I see in the epilepsy grand round seminars naturally show the videos happening.
Oh, okay.
Patient almost died, patient died, and so on and so forth. They actually see on the video that, you know, all the signal events happening.
Yeah, so they have video at the same time, they are looking at the signal, and then they can,
they can correlate. That's when it's happening.
Right.
So these are all patients with severe epilepsy? Because you're saying, you're assuming that they have had seizures within this 5-day period.
They may not have. But they have to be evaluated. So the seizure is, you know, within the 5 days it does not occur. It's very frustrating. You know, I've heard my collaborator complaining of, you know, we admit them and then they didn't have seizure earlier, and we evaluate them in the clinic and they're having seizures. So that's frustrating, definitely. It's but another important part is they can induce seizure through stimulation of the electrodes. That I won't get into. They're actually using brain stimulation for Alzheimer's disease, for dementia, and now epilepsy. FDA just approved, late last year, electrodes for stimulation-based therapy for epilepsy patients.
Are these events a static set? Because you're mapping it to some classes there, right?
This is time.
Yeah, those the names of the events, because if you have to query it back,
Yes. That's what. Right now, they were just writing it down. It was a text box that they were filling it in. We are mapping it to the ontology boxes. Okay. simple example many of you would find interesting. In the EDF file, all the recordings are in these sort of rows. So you have these channels, the ones that we saw for each of the channels. For a particular time period, everything is collected in one row. But as you clearly saw in the previous slide, you're actually looking across all the channels, and you are looking for one channel, how it's performing over a period of time. This kind of format, when it was invented, proposed 10, 12 years ago, they never thought that somebody would have to actually use it on a large scale. They were just looking at the first attempt to organize that information. So just the simple task of putting all the recordings from channel 1 into this kind of format, we just, you know, earlier they would take, I think, 5-6 days to put it into a format that could be put into a visualization interface and then visualize it. This is a simple task, a MapReduce task, and the kind of performance gain we are getting was tremendous. This is a simple pilot project. We were able to, I think, publish this in EMEA. Processing time in terms of the scalability that you clearly see with increasing number of signals and increasing number of studies, clearly there's a case for using any of the Hadoop technology for doing these kind of tasks instead of doing it on a desktop. And when you have 36 terabytes of data, makes life a whole lot easier. So what we did is, right now, at the stage that we are in right now, is we are taking all these EDF files, converting and it's not just that one example that I showed. There's also a lot of other processing that's going on. And finally, what we are creating is called, you know, the CloudView signal format, where you have these different fragments. So instead of having all the information as a, you know, a monolithic data set in EDF files, we are able to segment it into different parts, put in an object. Object is the notion that you can put it into different, you know, distributed file system kind of thing, with the required set of meta information that this object can be independently processed by any application. It does not have to depend on the original annotation file, the original metadata information. It's basically self-contained. And of course, what you're seeing of interest is we are annotating this with the ontology concepts. So the point is, now we are able to distribute this data and do the analytical processing, I'll come in the next couple of slides, on the signal segments in a MapReduce kind of concept. That was a fundamental problem. And that's why I was telling Dr. Prasad, when you take data and put it in the MapReduce framework, it's not always easy to partition the data. You need some kind of logical method how to partition this information. And we had to spend some time trying to figure out how to do this so that we are not losing the information. That improves the responsiveness of the application. These are some of the values that we have access to. Actually, 30 node. I know you here, Noesis has much larger.
800 some nodes.
We are trying to work with a person at San Diego Supercomputing Center as part of the NSF thing I mentioned. We'll see. The problem always is because we can't transfer the data without IAB approval. That's always an issue. This is within the case firewall. So the other thing of interest is, once you have this data, so what? So this, that was everything that I showed was a simple sort of data processing step. The clinical interest is, if you take ECG data, what we did was many of the clinical applications ask you to identify in the ECG data what's called a QRS complex. QRS complex is the normal functioning of the heart, starting from pumping of the blood and, you know, the whole process that the four chambers of the heart go through. And what's of clinical interest is instantaneous heart rate. How many heartbeats there are per second or per particular point of time. And of course, the distance between two, what is called as R peaks. So there are signal processing algorithms that detect this automatically over ECG data. What we did as, you know, sort of again, a sort of pilot implementation, we said, can we take these algorithms, these open source algorithms actually from MIT, the PhysioNet project which has been going on for 15 years funded by the NIH. We took that, just did a data dependency analysis, and then wrote a MapReduce script, this thing for that. And the results were, we were getting 20 times faster performance over the huge amounts of data for this clinically relevant signal events, automatically detected in context of MapReduce. So from the point is, there, the data partitioning, of course, is something that has to be considered. But once we are able to solve that, you now quickly move into supporting the kind of real-time response through data analysis for clinically relevant events that clinicians are looking for. And clearly, there's a role for any of the Hadoop technology stack in this kind of solving these problems. This is something very interesting. This is not our work. This is actually from the Genelia Farms. That's part of the Robert Hughes Medical Institute. They use Spark on a larval fish. This is published. Many of you can look up. This is a very nice paper and sort of puts it together how this Hadoop Spark specifically can be used in neuroscience. And one of the authors is actually from the Berkeley database group, who has developed Spark, basically, the co-authors. Many of you would be like interested to see that. But they were able to detect and process this data and detect events using Apache Sparks for this new method of imaging. They call brain light. She don't ask me. I have limited understanding of what's going on here. But they clearly spell out all the algorithms that they were able to use in Spark. So it's not only us. I mean, I haven't seen any other publication that has been using Hadoop for human data. We were among the only ones because we have access to the data. Lucky enough, you know, our collaborators are right there. But people are already using in neuroscience all of this. And there's clear value to this. As this brain initiative gathers traction, we'll see more of these publications coming, you know, being published and sort of being available. The last part I just want to briefly mention is the interface part that we have been building for supporting cohort identification as part of the managing epilepsy. Well, it's a network funded by the CDC across 8 different centers in the US. These are community-based outreach programs where they're teaching how patients with epilepsy can live in the community with just simple management techniques. The issue has been that each one of them has been doing their own study. There's been no data integration. But if you think, they are all following a same objective. They have the same objective, how to make develop new techniques to make life of epilepsy patients better in the community. So it makes sense to actually integrate the data and see what is working and what is not working. It's called comparative effectiveness in biomedical informatics. Which technique is better, which technique is not good, which populations, they are recruiting specific socioeconomic profiles of subpopulations. Which technique works better in, let's say, black Americans with high income rate versus white Americans with less income rate and so on. But till now, most of them are medical people. They are using Access and Excel spreadsheets to collect their data. They haven't even looked at any kind of relational database, let alone semantic web or any kind of other techniques to store the data. So what we did was we integrated the data set using ETL, approach and put it in a MySQL. It's not big data set. But on top of that, what we did is we added this provenance information of how each study is collecting their variables. What is the inclusion criteria? What is the exclusion criteria? Which population is being focused on in each study? So this, I guess the animation is not working. So the users can actually select from a drop-down menu the inclusion and exclusion criteria and find the studies that have comparable information. And once that is selected, then they can select the data elements that are of interest and create their cohorts. And of course, for immediate data sort of feedback, you get all this simple visualization of what is the racial distribution in this particular study values. So those simple kind of tools make life a lot easier and helps clinicians, bring clinicians on board to use informatics to do the kind of research that they're interested in. Of course, on top of that, we have to find out what statistical approaches we can use as the size of the data increases. We have now about 15 studies in the pipeline. Previously conducted studies and everybody who's working in this whole domain of epilepsy self-management, we want to create a national data repository. That single point that anybody can come in and look at the data and then create the cohorts and run the studies. We actually have a working group with protocol that you can submit your research, proposed research for approval. Once you're approved, you sign a data user agreement and we give you access to this informatics platform that they can use. I won't go into that. This is some of the mistakes. So I'll finish now. I think I'm over time. What we are trying to do is sort of combine immediate sort of urgent neuroscience focus, because that's what I'm working on, but you can take it to any other domain. But patient data capture, clinical text processing, data integration, signal data, of course, are more neurological focused, but research study cohorts. And you take all these things that most of us are familiar with, are working on, have spent a lot of time and experts in. They have application in these research problems. They can help address these research problems. These are real world research problems that are advancing. So use of OPIC is basically trying to identify biomarkers for sudden unexpected death in epilepsy. And this tool is enabling them using ontology. So clearly there is a lot of scope here. And you know, most of these applications that we have built are in close collaboration with clinicians, and their adoption shows that the approach that we learned here in terms of doing interdisciplinary research, you have to bring the stakeholders on board and implement the systems that are of use to them. And just to finish, these are some of my collaborators. Dr. Samdin Latu is the director of the Epilepsy Center. Dr. Martha Sajatovich is she's an endowed chair in as part of the new project. Cameron McIntyre, he is just recently had also holds an endowed chair role. He's an associate professor. He's world famous. Kenneth Loparo, he does signal processing. Neil Meropol, he's the associate director of the Case Comprehensive Research Center. We build basically alert system for clinical trial recruitment tool for them. GQ Zhang was at Case Western. He recruited me in the Division of Medical Informatics. Now he's moved to University of Kentucky. Curtis Tasoka, he is a biostatistician, and Will Shu is at UCLA in the radiology department. He's working on the big data for they're developing a lung cancer registry for veterans, and we're trying to use the provenance of how the data has been collected similarly for that. Actually, interestingly, Will I met at NLM when I first went for internship with OVP. And these are my funding resources and students, as I mentioned, Meng Zhao. And Meng Zhao is the one who worked on OPIC, Catherine worked on CloudWave. Priya is working on the Insight. Deepak is actually a neurology resident who worked on developing the ontology. Bilal is similarly a neurology resident. Ali Reza is also a neurology resident. Anand is who's working on the PIC script for signal processing. And Lee Song worked on the EPDF, the clinical. Questions?
Thank you. Good.
Sunjay, any question? See the analogy, the kind of stuff that you have some interest in?
You have a lot of students.
Yeah, some of them graduated. I only have right now Anand and Priya who are still working. Catherine graduated last year.
Yeah.
So most of them are like a PhD or master's?
Catherine and Lee Song were the PhD students. Everybody else was master's. These are not my students. They are neurology residents who worked on because they're interested in informatics. So they work with us. Bilal is actually working, still working on the Center for Student Research funded by NIDS. Yeah.
Satya, I had a question on the time series data that you collect. So are there any solutions that you have found useful? So let's say you have patient data for a week, and maybe if it is for 100 patients, you have a lot more data now compared to just one patient. So what kind of databases you use for time series data storage and extraction?
Right,
yeah, like the final you use a file format. I mean, that's the convention, I think.
That's the convention. That's file.
Okay.
They have no notion of databases. We are actually building the database as part of the Signal Data Cloud project or the CloudWave project for them. So
okay. The
first step was how to put it on HDFS. That's a huge problem by itself. So we solved that by this new data partitioning approach. We added the annotation part, make sure that these are self-descriptive objects that you can take out from any data node in HDFS and process it and run your algorithms instead of having to wait for getting the
retrieval, right? You're avoiding the retrieval time by just putting everything in one object.
Yes.
So annotations are not data points in the real time?
Yes. Yes, they are associated with data time points in the data.
Sarah, she has a paper for her work at GE where she did the annotation of radiologists, right?
Yeah, with the clinical text, radiologist text that they put,
uh-huh.
And they were interested in finding similar patient records with the current condition, so we use RedLex, which is a radiologist.
RedLex, uh-huh. Okay, so what? How are the terms being controlled? There's a controlled vocabulary?
Yeah,
no.
Yeah.
So this is an ontology?
It's a terminology.
Okay.
It's a terminology with taxonomic relationships.
And they search for keywords?
Yeah, because early it was based on the image and the type.
Uh-huh.
Based on that, they are trying to give the similar patient reports. But
but they wanted more semantic approach, so yeah, based on the relationship between the terms, how to phrase
it. So it's a hierarchy, right?
It's
now,
a
right?
hierarchy.
It's, okay. I'll talk to you then later on there to see what
So, are you currently using Hadoop and then processing for on-demand or instant answering of questions or analysis?
No, it's batch processing right now. So we are doing offline processing right now to put it in a format that we require. Right now we are moving towards where we'll build the querying system that we're interested in, but it's not important.
You might want to look at it as Spark, right?
Yeah.
So if you correctly understood, all the semantic part is partially on the annotation, and then you apply the query after to provide the insight to the annotation. Did you try some, you know, semantic processing on the fly or something like that?
Semantic what?
I mean, maybe it's my bias. I'm working on something called stream reasoning, which try to process on the fly semantically.
Mm-hmm.
So, I mean, did you try something like for put together the annotation part and immediately the application of Spark queries or some semantic processing immediately, like, yeah, before the story?
That's another point. So what I have seen with all the ontological data that I have worked with, most of the reasoning has been subsumption reasoning, just going up and down the hierarchy. Why? Because in case of research cohorts, the clinicians will apply very specific terminology when they are saying this patient suffers from what. But when you are doing research cohorts, you are saying, find me all focal epilepsy patients. Now, focal epilepsy patients has, you know, 15-level deep classification. But that's the kind of reasoning that they're looking for, that you should get all the patients. Sparkle query, you know, graph traversal, it's not all, none of this data is in RDF right now.
Mm-hmm.
We are going to move, in the provenance data set, we are going to move to use RDF. That's very interesting from a computer science perspective, but if
right.
you look at it from the practical application perspective, they don't have need for it right now.
Okay.
So unless you justify saying, you know, let's say based on the class level restrictions in OWL, I can infer something. I haven't seen anything like that. So the maximum the reasoning that we have done is subsumption hierarchy. And you can do that, you know, pretty easily, and in semantic web community, we have been doing this for the last 5-7 years now. So we haven't done anything. We haven't come across any requirement as such, and I haven't tried anything.
I mean, you have already a requirement that integration is pretty wide with RDF. It's easily to reach.
RDF has its own complexity and advantages.
Right.
Data integration, you can store the data. Right now, we are using MySQL. The last one inside that I show with MySQL is fine because it's about, you know, 500 patients. Clear, you know, defined requirements. Right now we haven't come to that. But definitely, that's something we have worked on that during my grad studies and everything. I know that this thing, but we haven't come across a requirement.
So right now, the So
offset is the data capture, and then you capture kind of structure. You can, because that from the down. And you have a clinical text, right? So these two things, are you, in this particular work, are you restricting that or encouraging that you should use OPEC, or is these two things are completely
complementary.
And then you capture a different set of data in clinical text
No. So complementary in the sense that till now, till 2013-14,
yeah.
Before OPEC was developed, they had been using Word documents. And that data is there. We need to be able to use it. How do we use it? That's why we built the clinical text processing pipeline.
Yeah.
But once it's incorporated, then there's no need to go back to that in some sense. From now on, it'll be OPEC only.
Okay, so the richness, right? When I'm writing something, I'm doing that, I can write anything.
Mm-hmm.
Right? So how do you capture that richness into data capturing system like OPEC?
Excellent. So it's not completely all structured data. There are places where you can add sentences.
Okay.
So you might need some amount of clinical text processing on that, but it's a very small set. We are trying to minimize that or even eliminate that if possible in some sections of the data itself.
The exact question, I think my question previously was related to that.
Okay.
Because if you leave that textual thing, right, that is the, I think for extended research, that is what is important than your structured data, because your structured data, you actually know what is where. But one of the things is...
The research, when you say computer science research or clinical research?
Clinical research, right?
No. So clinical research, you know, medication information, seizure events, these are standard terminology they use. But
right,
when you're doing research, you compare across population or you look into, you know, what kind of seizure is occurring. So that information is clinically relevant.
Because these are all, I feel, very personalized, right? So seizures might be very personalized. So it might depend on the habits of a person. It might be, no?
No.
Okay.
I mean, habit, if you're saying drug abuse in some sense induces seizure, possible. But the kind of seizure occurring or patient suffering from epilepsy is not individual. Etiology can be, as I said, brain trauma, genetic, development of lesions, that kind of thing. These are clinical events rather than personal.
I feel restricting the unstructured text, right, might restrict their thinking.
No.
Okay.
So the richness is not lost if you structure it. No. You are able to capture all the information they require. But using the terms is fast to consistent.
How do you collect the EEG data? EEG data, signal data. Do you put the portable sensors on the patient, or do you ask the patient to come to the medical center to take the EEG regularly?
They are admitted. Admitted to the hospital. Then surgeons put in the electrodes. There are different kinds of recording. So there's something called scalp EEG. You put on the surface of the head. The intracranial is more sophisticated because it gives you very precise recording of events. The scalp EEG can't. Because events are occurring deep inside the brain, you need to have electrodes at those positions to see exactly what's going on.
So based on the EEG, you could predict the seizure is going to happen before it happens.
That's an open problem in neurosciences. There are many people who will say, yes, we have done it, and there will be clinicians who say they don't know what they're talking about. So, it's a challenge. It's a machine learning approach that many people at the UPenn and CMU have worked on. There are some devices approved by the FDA that says a couple of seconds before seizure occurs, we can predict. But if you talk to the clinician, they'll say, works off and on, and there are a lot of caveats associated with it. There's no successful silver bullet.
Similar to accurate prediction.
So how do you do the retrieval once the data is in? Like, do you use query-based, like a semantic techniques or?
Query-based semantic techniques, yes. So the Insight platform that I last showed, Priya is using Owl API to reason over the epilepsy pathology to retrieve the cohort.
So you can use the similar concepts?
Similar concepts, yes. You can use RDFS label or C also, or even the subclass of relationships. Those, yes. Right now, that's what you're doing.
So now it is faster if you move to the Hadoop-based systems?
Possible. But the data size is not large enough that you see a difference, actually. We did a simple evaluation. It's a very small amount of patient population we have right now. The interesting part would be in signal data. When the volume is large, then you bring in these real-time, any of maybe Spark specifically. I haven't used Spark, I have very little knowledge. That would make a difference.
All right. Thank you.
Yes.